Mr. Excel Podcast, sponsored by Easy Excel. Learn Excel from Mr. Excel Podcast, episode 1656, VBA, selecting the whole range. Hey, I want to thank Pete for sending a question in today. He had watched episode 1481 about taking a macro and wrapping it in a for next loop, and Pete was asking some questions about that. And so I answered Pete's questions, but then something that he wasn't even asking about just kind of it worried me in his code. And so I want to talk about the recorded code designed to select all cells in a table. First, just a little bit about Pete's code. Pete is running a query, and he has a list of items on sheet one, and he wants to run the query for each of those items. Okay, so I said, hey, first thing, because we're dealing with two worksheets here, that's more complicated than 1481, and I'm always worried when I have multiple sheets that I'm going to do something in the macro that's going to switch the active sheet to something I didn't expect. Do a sheets.add, that's going to switch to the other sheet. And so let's just be overly cautious and create three object variables, one for your sheet one, I'll call that WS1, one for your data sheet, I'll call that WSD, and then one for the new worksheets that you're creating, I'll call that WSN. For the two that are hard-coded, let's say, we just assign it to sheet one and then data, WSN is defined as we go. We're doing sheets.add down here. I add a parenthesis there, and set WSN equal to. All right, and then when we're referring to things, like we're getting the next value from sheet one, I can say WS1 dot cells I comma one. All right, that way I always know I'm going back to sheet one, even if the new sheet happens to be activated because of the paste or because of the sheets.add. All right, so that was my first thing. But then I noticed this code that the macro recorder had done. It looks like Pete has a table, right, because they're using this table nomenclature here, and starting from a column called file or file name, and then it's starting from that cell and doing a selection dot end down, so in other words pressing control down arrow, and then it's selecting from that selection, which I imagine to be an entire column, and doing selection dot end right arrow. All right, so I can picture he's getting a whole big block of text there, doing a copy, and then adding a sheet and pasting. I started to think about this. All right, so here's, I don't know what Pete's data looks like. All right, so that's my first problem, but I can picture it probably looks something like this. And so let's just do what the macro did. We select the heading called file name, control shift down arrow, control shift right arrow, and that gets the whole range. That's great. But depending on this data that's returned by the query, we didn't create that data, and you never know what kind of system it was. Maybe it allows blanks. So here we have a different item and there's some blanks. I do the exact same code, control shift down arrow, control shift right arrow, and I'm not getting the whole range, right? So that makes me really, really nervous. And I wanted to say to Pete, I said, Pete, it would be a lot better if you could come here from A5 and do control asterisk. Control asterisk selects the current region. Right, and so I just wanted to change Pete's code, right? He's not asking me about that part of the code, but I desperately wanted to take Pete's code and put control asterisk in there, which is called dot current region. But then I started to have all kinds of misgivings because I can't see what Pete's data looks like. Maybe Pete has some really nice instructions up here or something like that. And maybe, although I would always leave a blank row above my table, maybe Pete didn't. And so then if Pete comes to the word file name and does control asterisk, his macro is now going to be copying stuff that he didn't want it to copy. And I'm like, in this table nomenclature, maybe column A isn't file name, maybe column D is file name, and Pete wanted to start from D5 and do control shift down arrow, control shift right arrow. And if that's the case, now my control asterisk is going to be causing problems. All right, so Pete, here we go. Assuming that you can have a blank row above the data, and that file name is the first column of your table, I would like to change the macro like this. We're going to just do WSD.range A5, and I'm going to hard code that, and you're going to have to figure out where your first top left corner cell starts. Dot current region, all right, and that's going to extend in all directions until it hits the blank row and blank column. A single blank cell here and there, though, will not cause the problem. All right, so just doing that bit right there is very similar to all of those lines of code. And then you're getting just the visible cells, so in other words, the results of the filter although in Pete's case he's actually doing a query that's returning just the right bit, so he wouldn't have to add this. And then we can do a dot copy. Alright, so all of that one line of code actually replaces these four lines of code. Boy, and I really want to click delete right there, but I'm just going to comment them out for right now. And then Pete adds a sheet using sheets.add, but here I want to use my version instead that actually assigns it to an object variable. So I'm going to copy that line of code, Control X, and do the new sheet before I do the copy, because you're allowed to do the copy and paste in one line by specifying the destination. And so that's going to be WSN, the sheet I just created, range A1. All right, so there's our copy and paste. So now that one line of code also replaces these two lines of code. So there we go. And then also added a section down here that made the new worksheet have a name equal to this value from sheet 1. All right, although in case the value from sheet 1 has an illegal character like an apostrophe or something you can't put in a sheet name, I just said, hey, if that's going to throw an error and stop the macro, then just go on to the next one. That's okay, we'll let that one be called sheet 87 instead of stopping the macro. All right, so let's just take a quick look back here. We have our list of items to process. You know, it might be hundreds of items, who knows. Here's our table. We have two worksheets right now, and we'll run the macro. Bam, right there, I saw new things get inserted over in the Project Explorer. All right, and there is our apple with just the apples, banana, cherry, dill, and eggplant. Kudos to Pete. This is going to be a great little macro here, wrapping it in a loop, being able to run all that. It's like when you take your car to the mechanic and say, hey, I have a problem over here, and the mechanic says, oh, hey, you also have a problem over here. So, you know, sorry to stick my nose in this, but I'm worried that, you know, some days this isn't going to work, and we can actually just shorten it up with one line of code down here and have a nice, quick little macro to solve the problem. All right, I want to thank Pete for sending that question in. I want to thank you for stopping by. We'll see you next time for another netcast from Mr. Excel.